ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله، الحمد لله حمد عباده الذاكرين الشاكرين، حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده، وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We continue إن شاء الله on our study of the second successor of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Al-Farooq, Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him. And we remember how Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke of the dream that he saw, how he was drinking out of a bowl of milk, and then in that bowl the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I drank until I was full, and I saw it's filling my body until it's about to come out of my fingernails, and then in that bowl there was some left and I gave it to Umar. And the Sahaba asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is your interpretation of this dream, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He said, this is the ilm, this is the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in the hearts of the Muslim. This is the knowledge of the religion, this is the knowledge of Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about this great Muslim, the great star in Islam, Umar, he said that before you, the nations before you had people called muhaddathun. They Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired them, does not reveal Quran or wahi to them, but inspire them. And if there is one in my nation, it would be Umar. And I started today's study group with these two examples because when we read and study over the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab, we stop at certain things and certain opinions and certain situations where, subhanAllah, the vision of this man is way beyond, is way ahead of his time. And in our session today, inshallah, we'll try to touch on a few subjects and we see how Umar ibn al-Khattab's vision was so vast and so inclusive of so many things that are not only related to government, but related to life in general, and how he would connect these issues that some of them not even did not take place in many other nations till the 20th and 21st centuries, and he would crystallize these ideas, and he would work on it and advise people with it. One of these things is his interest and his recommendation towards how Muslims, how people should take care of their own health, their own well-being. And here's some of the stories that are narrated and the historian reported about Umar ibn al-Khattab. Ibn al-Jawzi narrated that Umar ibn al-Khattab one time saw a man who has a belly, who is obese and has a big belly, maybe like mine. And he asked him, he said, what is this? He said, ma hadha, what is this sitting here? He said, hadihi barakatun min Allah. This is blessing from Allah. He said, this is my belly, is blessing from Allah. And Umar said, bal azabun min Allah. This is torment. This is torment from Allah. What are you trying to do to yourself? And Umar then said, ayyuhal nas, iyyakum wal bitma. This, beware of obesity. Beware of becoming fat. Wa ani ta'am. This, be careful what you eat. فَإِنَّهَا مَكْسَلَةٌ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. It makes you lazy when you come up for prayer. It makes you heavy. You don't do as much. مَفْسَدَةٌ لِلْجِسْمِ مَوْرَثَةٌ لِلسَّقْمِ. That it spoils your bodies and it makes it more prone to develop diseases. I mean, subhanAllah, how did he know that? How, see that vision of this man, the things that we now know today about overweight and obesity, subhanAllah. And then he said, وَلَكِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْقِصْدِ فِي رَحِمَكُمْ اللَّهُ وَلَكِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْقِصْدِ فِي قُوتِكُمْ. Be moderate, be modest what you eat. الاقتصاد is being moderate, being careful of what you eat. فَإِنَّهُ أَدْنَى مِنَ الصَّلَاحِ وَأَبْعَدُ مِنَ السَّرَفِ. It is better for your righteousness and it makes you not an extravagant person. You see, don't eat too much and indulge in that pleasure. وَأَقْوَى عَلَى عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. You'll be stronger in your worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you will sleep less and you will be more active and you can do qiyam layl and etc. And then he said, وَلَنْ يَهْلُكَ عَبْدٌ حَتَّى يُؤْثِرَ شَهْوَتَهُ عَلَى دِينِهِ. That the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would not perish, meaning that he will not not do good with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and unless he prefers his own pleasures, and food is one of the pleasures of life, he prefers the pleasure over Allah, over the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the things that Umar ibn Khattab spoke of, general health, of public health issues, if you will, is quarantining people with contagious diseases. One time he saw a woman in the masjid, and she had a skin disease known as al-judham in Arabic, and that skin disease is contagious. And he ordered that woman to stay at home. And he said, you shall not come to the masjid while you have this disease. And she obeyed Umar. Well, she actually, after she was cured, she continued to be in her house. She would not come to the masjid. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab dies, and a man came to her and he said, إِنَّ الَّذِي مَنَعَكِ قَدْ مَاتِ. The one that prevented you is dead. And she said, وَاللَّهِ مَا كُنْتُ لِأُطِيعَهُ حَيًّا وَأَعْصِيهِ مَيِّتًا. I would not obey him while he was alive and disobey him after his death. And she continued to not actually come out and see people, fearing that she may spread disease that she carried at one time. Then Umar ibn al-Khattab, in public health issues as well, he emphasized general activity. He emphasized the workout, to have a sport. And he said, عَلِّمُوا أَوْلَادَكُمُ الْعَوْمَ وَالرِّمَايَةِ وَمُرُوهُمْ فَلْيَثِبُوا عَلَى الْخَيْلِ وَثْبَى. He said, teach your children swimming and teach them الرِّمَايَة, target shooting, and ask them to jump on the back of horses. That means teach them how to ride horses. So just teach them the skills that will keep their bodies healthy, and it will be beneficial for them later on. It'll make them stronger to protect their religion and protect their families. And then he also continued, he said, وَرَوُّهُمْ مَا جَمُلَ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ, that teach them the beautiful poetry, teach them what is the poetry that has wisdom in it, meaning that general education as well. Is he also not only emphasized the teaching of religion, but he also emphasized teaching outside that people have also have to learn other things that would be beneficial for them in their daily living. And this is just a small synopsis of what Umar ibn al-Khattab has emphasized and recommended and enjoined upon Muslims during his time for public health, general education, and taking care of their own bodies and their own families. Umar ibn al-Khattab also had some social recommendations for people in their own social gathering, and he liked that people not have exclusive clubs, did not like people with small groups of people, and not letting other Muslims or other people into these circles of closed circles of friends. And he did not like people to have classes that are basically based on social status, not on anything else. And Ibn Abbas directed upon Umar that he said to people of Quraysh, بَلَغَنِي أَنَّكُمْ تَتَّخِذُونَ مَجَالِسِ, I heard that you have special gatherings, and they would have special sort of clubs. لَا يَجْلِسُ إِثْنَانِ مَعًا حَتَّى يُقَالُ مِنْ صَحَابَةِ فُلَانِ, that whenever two people sit together, they say, this person belongs to such and such circle of friend, that other person belongs, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, belongs to that other circle of friends. Hatta tuhumiyat al majalis, that now you are divided into certain clubs and certain classes. And he said, wa aymullahi, inna hadha la sari'un fi dinikum, sari'un fi sharafikum, sari'un fi dhati baynikum. This is dangerous. He said, this is bad for your own religion, and it is bad for your honor, and it is bad for your brotherhood amongst each other. It separates you. It makes you weaker, and subsequently, it makes your religion weaker, as you cannot defend it as one group. And he said, وَكَأَنِّي بِمَنْ يَأْتِي بَعْدَكُمْ يَقُولُ هَذَا رَأْيُ فُلَانَ قَدْ قَسَمُ الْإِسْلَامَ أَقْسَامًا. He said, after you, people will come and they will say, we follow the opinion of that gathering, and we follow the opinion of that gathering, and we will be dividing Islam into sects and sections. SubhanAllah, and he had this vision that some of it become became true later on. أَفِيدُوا مَجَالِسَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ He said, be together, sit together, do not divide your majalis, do not divide your gatherings. وَتَجَالَسُوا مَعًا And sit together. فَإِنَّهُ أَدْوَمُ لِأُلْفَتِكُمْ It is better that you would love each other and enjoy each other's company more. وَأَحْيَبُ لَكُمْ فِي النَّاسِ And it gives you more status among people, among other nations. You become more, not feared is not really the word I'm looking for, but people will know that you're a gathering to be reckoned with as one nation and one ummah. More respect, yes, more respect among people, jazakallah khair. So these are the things that he had, that type of vision, and that type of ilm that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam spoke of, and you see that Umar ibn al-Khattab had this opinions that we see that 1400 years ago, we still see that they're right, and they're filled with wisdom, and if we take it into today's life, in the 21st century, then we know that that is the right thing to do. But the main issue that we inshallah will study today is something started earlier on the days of Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, and continued into more formal shape on the days of Umar ibn al-Khattab, and it then became a department and the Muslim government later on the days of al-Khulafa and the Dawla al-Umawiyya, the Umayyad Khilafa and then the Abbasi Khilafa later on. And this is the matter of Al-Hisba. What Al-Hisba in Arabic, and if I have to translate it, and if I have to choose one word, I think it would be accountability. Al-Hisba, Al-Muhtasib, is what exactly equals to Inspector General today. It's somebody who can check on the government and can check and review the things that the government does. Yet they have also responsibilities to check on people in general, including the authorities, and making sure that people are doing what needs to be done, and the government is supervising that way in a manner that is acceptable to the system, which is Islam in this particular example. So this hisba is something that Umar ibn al-Khattab has established as a department, and he started that on an individual basis. What I mean by that is he took matter into his own hands. Number one, the Muslim ummah at that time was small, and his smaller place of emphasizing and applying his system of government was Al-Madinah, which was not a great big city at that time. So he would do things and take things and take matters into his own hand, but his system and his plans and his method of doing hisba became the example where the rest of the ones that followed Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Khulafa, that wanted to apply this, they followed the example that Umar set in place. And this hisba is revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hajj. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الذين مكناهم في الأرض أقاموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة وأمروا بالمعروف ونهوا عن المنكر ولله عاقبة الأمور. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in verse 41 of Surah Al-Hajj, Thus if we settle them on earth, that means if they have established their government, the rule on earth, now they have an entity, and meaning the Muslims, then they will do this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أقاموا الصلاة, they will establish a salat. وَآتَوِ الزَّكَاةِ And they will provide the zakah. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ Which is most of hisba is enjoining the good deeds and forbidding and prohibiting the bad, evil deeds of Islam. And the system of al-hisba, we'll divide that into small things that Umar ibn Khattab, multiple things that Umar ibn Khattab tried to do to responds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's call in this particular verse of Surah Al-Hajj, as now he established and he is establishing the Muslim ummah and wants to do the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered for those who want to establish an ummah. So the first thing is iqamat al-tawheed, is the tawheed, the worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purely and for the sake of Allah and not associating anything with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the most important first pillar of Islam. The second thing is establishing the worship. So first, the faith of Tawheed. Second, establishing the worship. Third, he started establishing the system in the marketplace and how people deal with each other. And in the marketplace was the economy of that Muslim ummah. And he wanted to organize that and did the hisba system on that particular entity. And then his check and how he emphasized to check on his own ra'iyya, on his own subjects, and to know that they're doing the things that he enjoined upon them to do, and they are actually cared for the way he wanted them to be cared for. So the first thing that we will speak of is at-tawheed, how Umar ibn al-Khattab protected the religion of at-tawheed, of making sure that la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, is applied, emphasized, and practiced in the government that he had. One story that is narrated on Umar ibn al-Khattab is his story with al-Hajar al-Aswad, with the black stone of al-Kaaba, that he wanted to make sure that people understand that they're not coming to the Kaaba to worship the stones of the Kaaba or to worship the building of the Kaaba. He wants to make sure that people understand what they're doing when they come and do the rituals of Hajj and Umrah. And he came to Al-Hijr al-Aswad, came to the black stone, and he kissed Al-Hijr al-Aswad, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he talked to the stone. Of course, he's not talking to the stone, he's talking to everybody else watching him, what he is doing and what he wants to teach his subject. And he said, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ حَجَرٌ. I know you are a piece of rock. لَا تَضُرُّ وَلَا تَنْفَعُ. That you do not bring benefit and you do not harm anybody. وَلَوْلَا أَنِّي رَأَيْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يُقَبِّلُكَ لَمَا قَبَّلْتُكَ. He said, have I not seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had I not seen the Prophet kiss you, I would not have kissed you. And he's making sure that people understand that what they're doing is they're following the Prophet's sunnah, not respecting the Hajar al-Aswad. They're respecting the way of the Prophet. They're respecting the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not giving that respect to the stone, to the Hajar al-Aswad. Another important thing that he did is we remember when upon the time of Bay'ad of Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, that the Sahaba, when Uthman was late, and I'm not going to go to the story too much, inshallah we studied that during our seerah sessions. Uthman was late and the Prophet ﷺ heard the rumor that Uthman was killed, and now Muslims that are coming for Umrah are being attacked, and their messenger, according to the rumor, was being killed. So now they're in jeopardy. And the Prophet gathered the Muslims under a tree, a big tree, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ. That this tree was mentioned in the Quran, that Allah is pleased with the Muslims, with the mu'min, that gave you the pledge under the tree. Well, things went on, and the times of Umar, people started respecting the tree, started coming to this monument of this important event that is mentioned in the Quran. And this bay'ah that is called, this pledge called bay'ah to shajara, that tree was there. And people started coming, praying under the shajara, started respecting, putting some marking on the shajara and making their dua at the shajara, at this tree. So Umar ibn al-Khattab ordered the shajara, this tree, to be cut. Because Islam doesn't have symbols. They don't create things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're not innovators in the religion. We don't do things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not ask us to do or made it clear for us what to do. And then he prevented this thing that started in his time and cut that tree. And it is really a very important symbol. It's a very important message for us is we to adhere to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to do and not innovate anything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do. Another thing that happened is there was a tomb in a place called Tustar And as far as I know, that's a place in Palestine, but I'm not sure. So if anybody has any information about that, please pitch in. But this place was, the people said that this is the grave, place, tomb of Daniel, or Al-Khidr, alayhi salam. The righteous man that was with Musa in Surah Al-Kahf. And people would come and respect and pay their respect and worship at that graveyard. So he wrote to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, who was the governor of Asham at that time, and he asked him to dig up that tomb and to dig 13 other graves and take the tomb and take the remains and put it in one of them, in one of these 13 at night, so nobody can see where the remains would be, and then to bury everything and mask it where there is no sign where the graveyard was, so nobody can come and try to find out where these remains are, whether that was Al-Khadr or not. But he wanted to make sure that people do not come to a grave and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at a grave, which is a bid'ah, which is a clear bid'ah that the Muslims subhanallah fall into a lot these days. And you see how they take the some of the graves of people they respect and they call righteous people, and they start worshipping and paying respect to the dead people, and they sometimes, astaghfirullah, they make prayers to these people and make them like an intercession between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is if it is not a form of shirk, I don't know what this is, subhanallah. And In the book of Al-Fatawa of Ibn Taymiyyah, this other story was narrated that Umar ibn al-Khattab saw people on a caravan, stepping out of the caravan and going to a place, and they would make salah there at the time of, there was no salah to be made. I mean, it was an nafil, obviously. And they would come back and join the caravan. He asked, what are these people doing? And they said, well, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed here once. So these people are coming here to pray where the Prophet ﷺ prayed. He said, إِنَّمَا هَلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ بِهَذَا. He said, this will destroy your religion, these things that you're doing. إِنَّهُمُ اتَّخَذُوا آثَارَ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ مَسَاجِدٍ. They took from the relics of their prophets places of worship. He said, we don't do that in Islam. He said, مَنْ أَدْرَكَتْهُ الصَّلَاةَ فَلْيُصَلِّ. Those, if it is time for salah, make salah wherever you want. وَإِلَّا فَلْيَمْضِي. Or go ahead and go on your trip. Another thing that he emphasized, tawheed, and he wants always to make sure that when something happens to Muslims, Muslims think of Allah and then us. Is there is no intercession. When Allah ordains and Allah decrees for something to happen, then that's what we believe that will happen. At the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, Khalid ibn al-Walid was moving from one victory to the other, from Ar-Ridda to Faris to Asham. When Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah asked for help in Asham, and we will study all of that in details, inshallah, Umar ibn al-Khattab would send him Khalid ibn al-Walid with few soldiers as a support, as great military leader. And people started talking, oh, we were defeated, Khalid was not there. We are victorious because Khalid was there. So they started associating Khalid with the cause and the reason for victory. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, what he did is he demoted Khalid. Is he took Khalid away from leadership. And he put Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah in general leadership of the armies of Hisham. And he said, and this is in Al-Bidayah wa Nihayah Ibn Kathir, he said, إِنِّي لَمْ أَعْزِلُ خَالِدًا عَنْ سَخَطَةٍ وَلَا خِيَانَةٍ. He said, I did not demote Khalid, I did not take him out of his position because I'm angry with him or out of betrayal or because he did anything wrong. وَلَكِنَّ النَّاسَ فُتِلُوا بِهِ. But people are now being tested by Khalid and they are admiring Khalid. فَأَحْبَبْتُ أَنْ يَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الصَّانِعُ. I wanted them to know that Allah is the one that gives victory and Allah only is the one that takes victory away from people. One time he saw a group of people from Yemen And they were sitting in the masjid and all day and not doing anything, and he will go to his work and come back, and they're sitting there and worshiping and doing good things. And he came to them. He said, "Man antum? Who are you?" They said, "Nahnu al-mutawakkilun." We are the ones that rely on Allah. We rely on Allah for our rizq. We rely on Allah. He said, "Bal antum al-mutawakkilun." He said, "You are the ones that qala bal antum al-muttakilun." You are the dependent. You are not the relying on Allah. You are dependent. You are not doing your part. And then he said, "Innama al-mutawakkilun man yulqi habatan fil ardi wa yatawakkalu ala Allah." He said, the mutawakkil, the real person that rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the one that takes the seed and plants in the earth and then rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he will do that part that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to work. He will plant the seed. You have to go out, you have to do something. And one of the things that Umar ibn al-Khattab has emphasized, as we saw, that he is not an innovator. He would not come up with something that is new in the religion, that would not be an addition to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has left for this ummah. He said that, أَلَا إِنَّ أَصْحَابَ الرَّأِي أَعْدَاءَ السُّنَنِ. Those who are enemies of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أَعْيَدْهُمُ الْأَحَادِيثُ أَنْ يَحْفَظُوهَا فَأَفْتَوْ بِرَأِيهِمْ. They did not try hard to memorize and seek the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to know, well, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have any ruling in this? فَأَفْتَوْ بِرَأِيهِمْ. They gave their own opinion. While there is a Prophet's opinion that they did not know, but they did not try to seek, and they did not say, "We don't know it." فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. They lost their way and they misguided other people. أَلَا وَإِنَّا نَقْتَدِي وَلَا نَبْتَدِي. That we follow and we do not start things that are not from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam opinion. وَنَتَّبِعُ وَلَا نَبْتَدِعُ. And we follow, we do not innovate. مَا نَضِلُّ مَا تَمَسَّكْنَا بِالْأَثَرِ. We will not be lost as long as we adhere to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam opinions and to his sunnah. And his adherence to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is obvious in that story that we said about kissing the black stone. There is another story about al-hajj itself that we know in the first, in a tawaf, in the beginning of a tawaf, we make sort of a fast walking or semi-jogging type of gait. That's how we walk in the beginning. And then people make al-adiba, which is exposing your right shoulder to show muscles. And we remember that happened in Umrat al-Qadha, when the Muslims came to Mecca, and the kuffar, the pagans of Mecca, said that the people, the Muslims, are weakened by the fever of Medina. Now they're weakened. So the Prophet ordered his companions to walk in this vigorous type of walking to show their strength and their health, and to show their muscles, to show the muscles of their right shoulders while they're doing this. But this is the sunnah now, and people are doing this. And Umar gave his opinion about this. He said, فِيمَ الرَّمَلَانُ وَقَدْ ظَهَرَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ. Why are we doing this? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has empowered Islam, and now Islam is dominant over Arabia, and at that time, most of the known world. He said, وَلَكِنَّ لَا نَدَعُ شَيْئًا كُنَّا نَفْعَلُهُ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. But we do not leave a ritual, a custom, that thing that we do with the Prophet صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. So that was the emphasis of Umar ibn al-Khattab upon following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam orders and sunnah. And I know that may bring some discussion later on. Inshallah, we'll talk about that. The second thing after tawheed and after establishing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his emphasis on al-ibadat, on the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The cornerstones, brothers, of Islam, of whole iman, is ما وقر في القلب وصدقه العمل. Is we have to let the iman settle in the heart. We have to let la ilaha illallah soak into our own soul, and then this has to be exposed and translated into actions, into deeds. And one of the deeds that Muslims do to emphasize la ilaha illallah is the acts of worship. And Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, knew the importance of these acts of worship. And one, the most important one of this is what? As-salah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ. This is the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in these verses of Surah Al-Hajj that we just narrated, that the first thing that these people do when they take power over them, their own affairs, is they start and establish a salah. And in one of his letters to the governors of Al-Amsar, of the conquered territory, he said, إِنَّ أَهَمَّ أَمْرَكُمْ عِنْدِيَ الصَّلَاةِ. The most important issue with me is as-salah. فَمَنْ حَفِظَهَا وَحَافَظَ عَلَيْهَا حَفِظَ دِينِهِ. Whoever protects his salah and carry on his salah on time, then he will be protecting his own religion. وَمَنْ ضَيَّعَهَا, whoever wastes the salah or neglects the salah, فَهُوَ لِمَا سِوَاهَا أَضْيَعَ. For the rest of the religion affair, he will be even more neglecting. If somebody neglects the matter, وَعَلَيْكُمْ السَّلَامُ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ, of as-salah. And his khushu', his worship and his humility with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, and I think we can call it that, is known as he would, we know Umar had a somewhat of a rough personality, and his tears are not easy to come by except in these situations. And Abdullah ibn Umar, his son, said, sallaytu khalfa Umar فَسَمِعْتُ حَنِينَهُ مِنْ وَرَاءِ ثَلَاثِ صُفُوفِ. He said his tearing and his weeping was heard three rows behind him as he was making this khushu and this indulgence in worship in Allah in his salah. And one time he saw a man making his salah and moving too much, making too many movements and too many things, and he said, لَوْ خَشَعَ قَلْبُ هَذَا لَخَشَعَتْ جَوَارِحُ. If his heart is making khushu, then he would not be making so many movements, and his body will make khushu'. And he would teach people the manners of salah and respecting the masjid. And Abdullah ibn Umar narrated upon the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with both of them. He said, كَانَ عُمَرُ ibn al-Khattab قَائِمًا يَوْمَ الْجُمُعَةِ. Umar ibn al-Khattab was on the minbar making the khutbah on the day of Jumu'ah. فَدَخَلَ رَجُلٌ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ الْأَوَّلِينَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَلَمْ يُسَمِّهِ. He said a man of muhajirin, of the first muhajirin with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, came to the masjid. And Umar was already on the minbar. Now if Umar was here, these types of Jumu'ah, mashallah, we will be all in trouble. He said, فَنَادَاهُ عُمَرْ أَيُّ سَاعَةٍ هَذِهِ. What time is this? He came late to the salah because the imam is already on the minbar. Umar cut his khutbah and he asked him, why are you late, basically? And the man said, إِنِّي شُغِلْتُ. He said, I was busy. فَلَمْ أَنْقَلِبُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِي حَتَّى سَمِعْتُ التَّأْذِينَ. He said, I did not get home, I did not arrive to the house until I heard the adhan. فَتَوَضَّأْتُ وَلَمْ أَجَدْ أَنْ تَوَضَّأْتُ. He said, I made wudu and I came to the masjid. So he thought he will get himself out of trouble. He told Umar, I was busy and I went home and I made wudu and I came here fast. He said, well, wudu aybun. You made wudu only. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يأمر بالغسل. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم enjoined upon us to make ghusl, to make the bath, shower. You have to make ghusl on the day of Jum'ah. He said, not only you're late, but you're also late to Al-Jum'ah and you have not made your ghusl for Jum'ah also. This is how important. And he didn't care if that Sahabi that came is one of the elite of Sahaba, Al-Muhajirun Al-Awwalun. He was one of the beginners of Islam, one of the Sabiqeen for Islam. And As-Sa'ib ibn Yazid narrated another story about the respect of masjid manner with Umar ibn al-Khattab. He said, كُنْتُ قَائِمًا فِي الْمَسْجِدِ فَحَصَبَنِي رَجُلٌ. He said, I was in the masjid and a man threw a small rock on me. فَنَظَرْتُ فَإِذَا هُوَ عُمَرٌ. It was Umar that threw a small rock. He wants to get his attention. فَقَالَ. And then I looked to Umar and said, what do you want? He said, اذهب فأتني بهذين. He said, he pointed to two people in the back of the masjid. He said, bring these people to me. He said, فذهبت فأتيته بهما. He said, I went and I brought these two men to him. And he said, من أنتما? He asked them, who are you, these two people? They said, من أهل الطائف. He said, we are from the Taif, from the Thaqif, from the people of Thaqif, from the city of Taif. Umar said, لو كنتما من أهل هذا البلد لأوجعتكما. He said, I would beat you had you been of this city. If you had not been guests coming from Taif, I would beat you up right now. ترفعان أصواتكما في مسجد رسول الله. He said, you were talking loud in the masjid of the prophets. And had you not been guests, have you not been not know what this is all about, then I would beat you. He said, he was bringing them to beat them. But since they are from Taif and they don't know the manners, and he tried to teach them, he said, next time, basically, you will be beaten if you raise your voice in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And one of the things that Umar ibn Khattab is one of his wives, and it's not, and this is in Sahih al-Bukhari. This story is from Sahih al-Bukhari, so it's got strong authentication. That one of his wives, and it's not named, the wife, she was not named, تصلي في المسجد. She used to come to the masjid to make salah. And Umar said, إِنَّكِ لَتَعْلَمِينَ مَا أُحِبْ. She said, you know what I like. He does not want her to come to the masjid. فَقَالَتْ وَاللَّهِ لَا أَنْتَهِي حَتَّى تَنْهَانِي. She said, I will not stop coming to the masjid until you order me not to do it. But Umar could not order her not to come to the masjid because the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا اسْتَأْذَنَتْ أَحَدَكُمُ امْرَأَتَهُ أَنْ تَأْتِيَ الْمَسْجِدْ فَلَا يَمْنَعْهَا. He said, if one of you, his wife, asked permission to come to the masjid, then one should not prevent the woman from coming to the masjid. Then he said, I will not prevent you from coming. He said, you know what I like is for you not to come to the masjid, but I will not ask you not to come. And Hadith al-Bukhari continues on, he said, فَطُعِنَا عُمَرْ وَإِنَّهَا لَفِي الْمَسْجِدِ. He said, the day he was stabbed, the day he was assassinated, may Allah be pleased, she was in the masjid. And she was there. So she continued to come, and he would not do something that the Prophet ﷺ did not clearly order not to do. His emphasis on the salah, as we continue on in this subject, Umar ibn al-Khattab was seen, and he was many times reported that he would stay at the masjid at night, and he would make qiyam, he would pray at night. And sometimes Sahaba would narrate that they would come to the masjid and they will see nobody except one man, and they would come closer, and it is Umar ibn al-Khattab having the salah at night. And then he would say, and one of his things that he would do is he would continue on his salah at his house, and then at the end, at the later part of the night, he would wake up his family and ask him to salah with him. And he said, as-salah, as-salah, and then he would recite, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا لَا نَسْأَلُكَ رِزْقًا نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى. He said, he would narrate of Taha 132, order your family for salah and be patient and endure upon salah. We don't ask you for sustenance, we provide, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides sustenance and rizq for his servants, and the reward is those who are righteous. One of the things that Umar ibn al-Khattab wished and loved is to make adhan. He knew what's in adhan, what kind of reward in calling adhan. And he would say, لو كنت أطيق الأذان مع الخلافة لأذنت. He said, if I can do the duties of adhan with the duties of khilafah, then I would become the muadhin. He would want to take this honor to himself. He wants to be the one to call adhan all the time. And he also emphasized the duty and the worship of ad-du'a, of praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of his known du'a, of known prayer, Allahumma ja'al amali kullahu saliha, waj'alhu liwajhika khalisa, wa la taj'al li ahadin fihi shay'a. He would pray to Allah, make all my deeds only to you and for you, and make it righteous and make it right. And then do not make any association in my deed and my worship to anybody other than you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the things that he would say, إِنِّي لَا أَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الْإِجَابَةِ وَإِنَّمَا أَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الدُّعَاءِ فَإِذَا أُلْهِمْتُ الدُّعَاءِ فَإِنَّ الْإِجَابَةَ مَعَهِ. He said, I don't worry about the response of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for dua. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, سَمِيعٌ قَرِيبٌ مُجِيبُ الدُّعَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to the dua. He said, I worry about the dua itself. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspires me to make dua, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to my dua. So he said, I always worry that I'm not making enough dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I know if I make dua, then Allah certainly will respond to this dua. As we continue on the subject of salah, one of the known things about Umar ibn al-Khattab is the issue of at-taraweeh, the salah of Ramadan, at-taraweeh. And the way it was narrated that Umar ibn al-Khattab, أن الفاروق خرج في ليلة من ليالي رمضان إلى المسجد فإذا الناس أوزاع متفرقون يصلي الرجل لنفسه ويصلي الرجل فيصلي بصلاته الرهط. He said one time Umar came on the night of Ramadan to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he saw people in small gathering and then individuals making this qiyam all by themselves. And we have also to remember not everybody at that early time knew how to recite Quran. There were so many nabaq, there were many foreigners that came to Medina that could not recite Quran very well. And they would follow an imam who was making this qiyam in the masjid. But they were small gathering and there would be many of them at the same time. And then Umar said, إِنِّي أَرَى لَوْ جَمَعْتُ هَؤُلَاءِ عَلَى قَارِئٍ وَاحِدٍ لَكَانَ أَمْثَلٍ. He said, I see if I gather them on one reciter, one person, it would be better. Then he started doing this taraweeh and he gathered them on Ubay ibn Ka'b. Ubay ibn Ka'b was known, was one of the authorities on Quran and a good reciter. And he started doing that. And then one time Umar ibn al-Khattab came and he saw Ubay ibn Ka'b and they saw the taraweeh. And he said, نعم البدعة هذه والتي ينامون عنها أفضل من التي يقومون. He said, the part that they sleep in is better than the part that they pray in. That means people do the taraweeh early, after Isha. But he said the part that they, after taraweeh, they go out their homes and sleep is the better time for making this qiyam and making this taraweeh. And some people say, well, here's an innovation. Here's something that Umar emphasized that he's not an innovator. He would not make something that's not from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But here is the issue of at-taraweeh. So how do you explain that? Well, the scholars said that Umar did not start the issue of at-taraweeh. It is known that it started at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the hadith that actually explains that. عن عروة بن الزبير أن عائشة رضي الله عنها أخبرت. It is narrated on the authority of Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم خرج ذات ليلة من جوف الليل فصلى في المسجد وصلى رجال بصلاته. He said, one night of Ramadan, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم went out to the masjid and started praying, and people gathered behind the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and they prayed with his prayer, with his night prayer. And then these people went home and they told others that the Prophet is praying in the masjid at night. فَاجْتَمَعَ أَكْثَرَ مِنْهُمْ. She said, the second night, there were more people, and the Prophet ﷺ prayed as an imam, and they prayed with him. فَكَثُرَ أَهْلُ الْمَسْجِدِ مِنَ اللَّيْلَةِ الثَّالِثَةِ. She said, the third night, the masjid was full. People came to do taraweeh with the Prophet ﷺ. فَلَمْ يَخْرُجْ فَخَرَجَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The third night he came out. The fourth night, عَجَزَ الْمَسْجِدُ عَنْ أَهْلِهِ. The fourth night, the masjid was full and people started being beyond the masjid. Everybody almost in Medina came to taraweeh. فَلَمْ يَخْرُجَ الرَّسُولُ. The Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم did not come out for this taraweeh. And then he came out for salat al-subh. He came out for fajr. فَلَمَّا قَضَى الْفَجْرِ أَقْبَلَ عَلَى النَّاسِ فَتَشَهَّدْ. He came to people and he started explaining to them after shahada and he said, أَمَّا بَعْدْ فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَخْفَ عَلَيَّ مَكَانَكُمْ. أَمَّا بَعْدْ, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, I saw what you were doing, I saw you were waiting for me all night. وَلَكِنِّي خَشِيتُ أَن تُفْرَضَ عَلَيْكُمْ فَتَعْجَزُ عَنْهَا. But I was afraid that this would become a fard if I started doing this every night with you, it would become a fard for Ramadan. and it will be hard for you. So I did not come out. So the idea of having the imam and doing the salah of taraweeh at the gathering in the masjid is a sunnah from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's not something that Umar ibn al-Khattab just invented and came up with. Yes, he revived this later on. And he, after this was not something that we need to worry about to be have farad, because after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, there is no new farad. So the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped doing the taraweeh is gone. So Umar thought it was a good idea, and he made this ijtihad that we still follow till today, that we should do the taraweeh as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did for these 3 nights. We continue on with the ibadat. Other than the salah, the second ibadah is zakah. We will, inshallah, save the zakah time as we will talk about Islamic economy and financial affairs of the Muslim at the time of Umar, and that will be, inshallah, a separate issue. But the other ibadah that Umar ibn al-Khattab organized and worked with was al-hajj. Al-hajj, he emphasized hajj so much that he said, Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, لقد هممت أن أبعث رجالا إلى هذه الأمصار فينظروا إلى من كان عنده جدة فلم يحج فيضرب عليهم الجزية. He said, I was going to send messengers, people, to Al-Amsar, to the states, to the new territories, and they look for people who are rich and capable, and they're not making Hajj, then they will be taxed in Jizya. They will be, those people who are not making, they're not Muslims. He said, those who have the wealth and the health to come for Hajj, and they're not coming, then they should be paying jizya. This is how much he emphasized the matter of al-Hajj. And then another thing he encouraged people to do is to make Umrah in throughout the year, which is actually, now it's one of the things that we, that Muslims do all over, but it was not the way of Muslims before. On the days of Abu Bakr, people did their Umrah during the months of Hajj. During the months of Hajj, they would do the Umrah. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab enjoined upon people and encouraged people to make Umrah all around the year, so the Masjid al-Haram will always be full with the people during the Tawaf and making the Umrah and wearing the Ihram all year around. Other than his interest and his emphasis on worship, he wanted to organize the affairs of Muslim in the marketplace, in tijara. Now, trading and being merchants and doing tijara was the occupation of the time. Muslims and mostly Arabs at that time were not people of industry, and they were not people of agriculture, but they were merchants. So we have to extrapolate his ruling of tijara into other affairs, because this was the backbone of the economy at that time. And whatever he said about trading does apply to trading in the Muslim fiqh, but also can be extrapolated to other professions, as this trading was the, as I said, the backbone of the economy and the most common things that Muslim did at that time. One thing Umar organized and emphasized in the marketplace is one of the earliest antitrust laws known to mankind. Umar was an anti-monopoly governor. He would not let anybody monopolize the marketplace. And it was known with many stories. One of them was narrated on Muslim ibn Jundub. He came to Medina, and he said there was time in Medina where food was scarce. There was not much food at that time. And then a caravan came with food. قَدِمَ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ طَعَامٌ فَخَرَجَ أَهْلُ السُّوقِ إِلَيْهِ فَابْتَاعُهُ. The richest merchants of the marketplace went out and they bought the caravan. Now they basically monopolized most of the food that is in Medina. And Umar came out to them. He said, أَفِي أَسْوَاقِنَا تَتَّجِرُونَ. That are you monopolizing our markets? Are you doing that? أَشْرِكُ النَّاسَ أَوْ اِخْرُجُوا. You either associate other people with your trade. You have to sell to everybody. You cannot just do this monopoly in your trading or leave the market. And then he said, لا حقرة في سوقنا. There is no monopoly in our market. ولا يعمد رجال بأيديهم فضول أذهاب إلى رزق الله نزل بساحتنا فيحتكرون علينا. He said, those who Allah gave them this extra gold, this extra money, and made them rich, they come and use that money to monopolize our market. And he prevented that practice. And if that was not really the principle of all antitrust laws that is practiced in the marketplace today to protect the economy, then I don't know what is. I mean, see how the vision of Umar ibn al-Khattab, how early is. I mean, this is 1400 years ago, and a man who was a shepherd and a small merchant in Mecca, subhanAllah. One other thing that he did is he would sometime prevent people from selling their goods at high prices. Yes, it was a free economy and a free market, but it has, as we are studying, it has rules and regulations. And a man came with oil. He had oil, and he started coming to the market, and he was selling it in an expensive price that is not a usual price for oil at that time. So Umar came to him, and he said, إِمَّا أَن تَبِيعَ بِسِعْرِ السُّوقِ. You have two choices here. You can either sell your oil with the market price, fair price for that oil. وَإِمَّا أَن تَرْحَلَ عَن سُوقِنَا. Or you take your oil and leave. فَإِنَّا لَا نُجْبِرُكَ عَلَى سِعْرِ. I'm not going to set a price for you. He said, I'm not going to tell you how much you're going to take for it, but you can either do this. I'm not going to take that oil from you and sell it with the price that I like. It's your oil. But you either sell it with the fair market price or you leave with your oil from this market. So he made sure that nobody will do this ihtikar, this monopoly, and nobody would monopolize and manipulate the prices in the marketplace. And another thing that Umar ibn Khattab did, and this is, subhanAllah, something that is well practiced, and it's one of the highest practice in the economy and the marketplace today, is he would obligate people that are trading to know knowledge about the marketplace, about trade itself, and about the rules of Islam of trading. So those who wants to become merchants and work in the marketplace, he said they have to know fuqah. They have to know the rules of trading in this marketplace. He said, لا يقعد في سوقنا من لا يعرف الربا. Those who do not know the rules of usury, do not know what riba is, they have doubt, they cannot sell and trade in our marketplace, because they will fall and make people fall into this pit of riba. And then he would when he hears about something that people did that is similar to riba, he would go there and hit them himself with his own stick. And he said, لا يبيع في سوقنا إلا من تفقه. Nobody can trade in the marketplace unless those who are learned, those who have knowledge about the marketplace. وإلا أكل الربا شاء أم أبا. Otherwise they will eat usury, they will eat the interest, whether they like it or not. It's going to happen to them, either out of malice or out of ignorance, just simply because they don't have the knowledge of trading in the marketplace. And this is in a way similar to what chambers of commerce do today, is they want to make sure that the marketplace is well organized, and the people that are trading know what they are doing, and they know what the market rules are. But take that to a higher level of Islam, where the rules of Islam and the rules of fuqah has to be known by people that practice that particular profession. An extrapolation of that can apply to any profession, to people, to teachers, to people that do handiwork, other things, because they know that they have to know the rules of Islam. They have to know that the good work has to be provided to the fullest. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ عَمِلَ مِنْكُمْ عَمَلًا فَلْيُتْقِنَهُ. Whatever you do your best when you're providing your work. That is the rules of Islam. Is if you are a teacher, you come to the classroom, then you do your best. You put everything you have in it. If you are a gardener, then you go and you do the best. If you are a physician, you do the same. If you, whatever you, your profession is you have to do your best in your work. And these are actually rules of fiqh. This is Islam. This is not a recommendation to make more money. This is how Muslims should practice every religion and every profession, they have. And that's one of the contribution of Umar ibn al-Khattab to the market and the economy of Muslims. And we see that the economy on the days of Umar took a steep rise, and Muslims became so rich, and that continued to go on until the days of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, may Allah be pleased with him, when people would load the gold on the camels, and they will take it from one city to the other looking for a poor person, and the camel will go back to the treasury of Muslims intact. Not one piece was missing, because there were no poor people in the Muslim world. And this is not fiction. This is not an imagination. This is something that happened following the rules of Islam. This is something that the Prophet ﷺ predicted in a hadith, that the sadaqah, the money, will go around from door to door in the entire Muslim ummah, and they will not find one person who is needy enough to take from that. I will stop inshallah here and open the floor for any comments, any additions, anything that I made mistakes up in, and if any questions that you may have, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Yeah, jazakallah khair. I think you came just a few minutes late, but we started that. The question is, how would, Umar was doing a great job, and we will see he will do a lot of these things that may seem that, yeah, this is great effort, but this applies to one or two situations, to one market, to one house, one woman that he would help. But Umar, number one, he was setting an example. He was teaching through actions. He was telling his governors, his rulers, his judges, what to do and how to do it. He's telling generations to come of Muslims what Umar thinks of these rulings, of these things that, and subhanAllah, just before Salah, we were discussing for 15 minutes some of the rulings of Umar ibn al-Khattab about marriage and other things. But what Umar is doing is setting an example. This is how you do this. He prevented people from monopolizing the market of Medina. But the lesson of that applies to every market in the Muslim Ummah for generations to come, not only for that particular market. And that's why we have this ilm. Another thing he would write, as you said, and that's exactly correct, is he would write these rulings, and many, many of these things came from his letters to his rulers and governors in the territories, and how to do it, and what to do, and we see when some of them would do something wrong, he'll bring them back, and he will punish them, like what he did to the son of Amr ibn al-As, when he transgressed, and he took he wronged a Christian person, and other many stories, that he would emphasize that, and he will make that a law of the land, and how we would do this thing. So it would actually transpire, it will go above and beyond the small events that he would used to do. Yes, Brother Uthmani. The question, and Brother Uthmani, and Allah knows best, is, was there a backlash from rich people to Umar, what Umar ibn al-Khattab was doing to them? Is he was preventing monopoly, was doing this antitrust things, and he would telling them how things will be. And I think part of the, and you correct me if I'm misreading the question, is we know that people with money are people with power. And usually the way we see these things today are people with money control the government. It's not the government that control people with money. And this is what we see in the world today. And how did Umar get away from, how did Umar not be subject to that? Was there a backlash? Was he? And the answer is no, he did not. Number one, the rules of Umar are the rules of Allah and the rules of Islam. Umar was not inventing things and applying things out of his own figment of imagination or his innovation. He was interpreting the rules of Islam and the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam into the marketplace. And that is very strong. That is very powerful. The power of faith that he was applying the rules. He would say, the laws of riba. Those who do not know riba cannot do this. So who can argue with that? Who can have, subhanAllah, subhanAllah, bihamdi. Who can have a backlash against something like that. And those who did, he knew how to discipline them very well. And that's what I said, he would go and beat them personally. Those who would, this is actually narrated, is he would take his stick and he would go and show the whole market what this person is going to suffer if they don't go along with the rules. And I think the problem with the world today is people with money think they have a lot of power because the stick has been very short. And nobody has used power to discipline people with money and let them know that that's not how you rule the world. It is the morality, it's the religion, it's the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that should rule the world and not the rules of the market. And whenever that happens, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Yes, jazakallah khair. The question is, brother said that Umar ibn Khattab did not allow some of his governors to wear fine clothes or ride fine horses, did not want them to have this luxurious look of the prince and the governor and all of that. And that's correct. And we know the story of Muawiyah. Muawiyah came to... But you know what he did with Muawiyah? Muawiyah came to Umar ibn Khattab, and this is the governor of Hisham, the richest principality at that time, and he came and he was wearing some of the fine clothes of Hisham, and Hisham was known for the clothes. So he came in, and assalamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, came to the majlis of Umar, and Umar take his stick and start beating him with no other warning. And the Sahaba came, stop, what are you doing? This is Sahabi. He said, I saw some pride in him. I saw a shadow of arrogance, so I wanted to help him. He said, أَرَدْتُ أَنْ أُعِينَهُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. So no, he would not allow these things to happen. Yes, Jazakallah. Then the Isha, inshaAllah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this, inshaAllah, more than entertainment and to make us follow these lessons and the rules and the wisdom, inshaAllah, that we learn from the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab and the Sahaba. And remember that this light that is shined through the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab is nothing but a reflection of what the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. So follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and adhere to it like these people did, and inshallah we'll be with them on the day of judgment. Ameen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa afdalu salati wa atamu taslim ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Adhan al-Isha, inshallah.